Christ alone, our chief cornerstone. No other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man. All other ground is sinking sand. Upon this rock you build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth, and in Jesus' name we will not fail, never.
Raised up from the dead, let captivity captive, it is finished. Oh, he gave us a keys.
I can testify that my life has been built on the foundation that was preached to me by my father, lived out by my parents. My life was built on that. My future, my marriage, my child, everything has been built on this foundation. This is what keeps us when things are happening that we don't fully understand. This is what anchors us, because we're not sure that we can trust God, that God is going to withhold something good from us if we obey him. But if you're willing and obedient, the Bible says, you will eat the good of the land. Don't focus on the good of the land. Focus on being willing and obedient.
The gates of hell will not prevail. No. When we bind and loose, we proclaim your truth. And in Jesus' name, we will not fail.
I don't want you carrying anything that you're not designed to carry. And so I need you to cast all these cares, some of the cares that you don't fully understand, cast those cares upon me. Why? Because I love you and I care for you, and allow my grace, which is sufficient in your weakness, to sustain you. Don't be troubled. There's a place that God has for you with him in his presence. I'm going to make sure that you are right with me. I am the way. There is the presence of God, and God rewards you with his very self, with his presence. The reward is the anointing of God. The reward is the grace of God. Your destination is smack dab in the perfect will of God, in the presence of God. So I want you to see it until it drives you. I want you to see it until it drives on the sacrifices. You're going to give up anything that you need to give up to get to that place in God.
Good morning, Winnie Christian Center. Come on, stand to your feet. I need some energy. If you got to be in the room, wave at me. Come on, wave at me. Come on. Everybody clap. Come on. Come on, I can't see you. Come on. Everybody clap your hands. Come on, we know this song. I need y'all to help sing it this morning. Come on. Say Yahweh. Yeah. Yahweh. Holy is your name. I don't want to take it in vain. Help me sing. Come on, sing. Say
Yahweh.
Say Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Holy is your name.
Holy is your name.
I don't want to take it in
vain.
Come on, need some fruit men in the room. Come on, everybody move. Come on. Yeah, 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 yeah. We're free in the room this morning. Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. I need your help. Say Yahweh. Say Yahweh. Say
Yahweh.
Holy is your name.
Holy is your name.
I don't want to take it.
I don't want to.
Sing it out, say Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Say Yahweh. Say
Yahweh.
Holy is your name.
Holy is your name.
Yeah, I don't wanna
take it.
Why? Cause there will be no other God before you. Help me sing it, say
there will be no other God before you.
Yeah. Cause there is no one. Besides
no
you,
nobody
like you,
nobody
Jesus.
Like you.
Said there will be
no other God before.
Yeah,
you.
And what we sing,
no
jump,
one,
jump,
no
come
one.
On. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. No,
no one, no one,
no one. Clap your hands in the room. Yeah. Here we go. I need y'all help. Come on, Yahweh, say
Yahweh,
say Yahweh.
Holy is your name. Holy is your
name. I don't
want to
take it.
I don't
want to
take it in vain.
That sound amazing. Come on, say Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Say Yah, Yah, Yahweh.
Yahweh.
Yeah. Holy is your name.
Holy is your name.
I don't want to take it in.
I don't
want to
take it in vain.
Here we go. Cause there will be.
There
come on.
Will be no other God before you.
Come on, if you decided to sing that in the room, come on. There will be.
Nobody
like you,
Jesus.
Say there will be
no other God before.
Come on, shout this out. No one.
No one.
Jump, jump. Yeah, 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 yeah. No one.
No one.
No one.
No one.
Yeah. Now come on, I need y'all to sing this next part. Come on. Here we go. No one. Who else can heal us? Lead us to freedom, say no.
No one, no one, no one.
And who else can heal all our sins and diseases?
No one, no one, no one.
And who else can walk on the waters?
No one, no one, no
yeah.
One.
And who else can answer by fire?
No one, no one,
who,
no
come on. Who else can bring down the tallest of giants, yeah?
No one, no one, no one.
And who else can shut the mouth of a lion?
No one, no one.
Here we go, come on. Who else is worthy of worship?
No one, no one.
Yeah, yeah. Who else is worthy of worship?
No one, no one.
No one. Jesus, come on. No one nowhere. Yeah,
no one nowhere.
Everybody clap your hands. Come on. Everybody clap your hands. Everybody clap your hands. Come on. There it is. Come on. Everybody clap your hands. Come on, yeah. Here we go. No one nowhere.
Nobody like you.
Come on, point to him.
Nobody like you, Jesus. No one nowhere.
Lover of my soul.
Lover of my soul.
Lover of my soul.
He loves us, he loves us,
yeah.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you.
Yeah,
yeah.
No one nowhere. Yeah,
no one nowhere.
One more time. Come on, sing.
Lover, lover of my soul.
Lover of my soul.
Clap your hands. Come on.
Lover of my soul.
Oh,
oh, oh.
Lover of my soul.
Nobody like you, Jesus.
Nobody like you.
Nobody like you. No one knows. Lover, lover of my
soul.
Lover of my
soul.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Nobody like you.
Come on, shout hallelujah in the room. Come on, where's my true worshipers at? Come on, come on, come on. Yeah, yeah, Jesus. Come on, put a praise on your lips. God, we thank you for your presence this morning. We don't take it for granted, God. We don't take driving here, sitting in this sanctuary for granted, Father. Will we expect the expectation of your presence? We expect you to move in the room. We expect to come and not leave the same, Father. We expect to leave liberated, to leave free, God, to no longer be bound. Come on. If you believe that you're going to be free this morning, come on, by the power of Jesus, come on, the one that's still saving, come on. Come on. He's Alpha, Omega. Come on. Come on. Come on. We press through this morning. Open up your mouths. Lift your hands. Come on. Yeah. Yeah. We call you Jireh, and we say you are more than enough. Come on, say he's Jireh, and he's more than enough. Come on, say it with confidence. Say he's Jireh, and he's more than enough. Let's go for it. Come on, stretch your hands in the room. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now.
Come here, Jay Shonda, come on.
Going through a storm, but I won't go.
An ocean,
so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
One voice, come on, sing it out. Come on, Jireh, sing.
Jireh,
you are enough.
You are enough.
Stretch your hands and sing it.
You are enough.
You are enough.
Oftentimes I can see so clear what it's all about. So stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't want to forget how I feel right now. So Jairus, say you are enough. Stretch your hands and sing it, yeah. You are enough. And I will be, yeah. In every, come on. Cause you are Jireh. You are. Come on, help me sing the bridge. Come on, yeah.
Worship him in the room, yes. Worship him in the room, yes. Give him praise in the room, yes. Give him praise in the room, yes. Shut your hands in the room, yeah, yeah, yeah. Give him praise in the room, yes. Give him praise in the room, yeah, yeah, yes. satisfied.
Come on, open up your mouths. Come on. If he's more than enough, come on. Come on. We call on the name of Jesus. Yeah. Oh. Come on. We speak a spirit of content in the room. Come on. That we won't be concerned about everyday life. Come on. Because we serve Jireh. Come on. We serve Jehovah. Come on. We serve Jesus. Come on. The name above every name. Come on. The name that still heals. The name that still saves. Come on. Open up your minds in the room. Yes. Hey. Come on, man. Come on. We going for it. Come on. Open up your minds in the room. Yeah.
Jesus, there is something about that name. Yes. We call him Master, Savior, Jesus.
Come on.
Yeah. Jesus, 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 there is hope.
Yeah. Sing it out.
Shall all pass away, but there is something about that name. There is something about that name. There is something about that name. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Come on, day to call the name Jesus. Come on, watch his spirit fall in this room. Come on, come on.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, yes. Jesus, yes. We call the name Jesus, yes. We call the name Jesus, yes. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
He's our firm foundation. He's our firm foundation. Come on, keep your hands stretched. Come on. Come on, keep your hands stretched. I don't hear you talking. Come on, open up your mouth. Come on.
He's the rock on which I lean. Yeah, when everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He never let me down. He's faithful through. Yeah, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. Whoa. Chaos. I got peace.
I got peace that makes no sense.
Let's drive it, come on. And I won't be going under. I'm not here, yeah,
yeah.
Cause I built my. Never left.
He's never let me down. He's faithful
every season.
So why would he fail now? Say,
so why would he fail?
Stronger
now?
He won't.
He won't.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He won't.
Yeah. More track in the room, come on. He won't.
He won't.
Yeah.
He won't.
Yeah.
He won't.
He won't fail.
He won't fail.
Here we go. Crisis.
Crisis, my firm foundation.
He's the rock.
Everything around me is shaking.
I've never been more glad.
I've never been more glad.
Come on, sing it out.
I put my faith in Jesus.
Come on, he's the one that died for me. Come on, sing.
He's never let me down.
He's able to generation. So why would he fail now? Come on.
So why would he fail?
My story, this is my song, yes. I haven't seen you fail me, yeah, yeah, yeah. One voice, I need to sing this next part. Unified. Rain came, wind blew. Come on, sing it out.
Rain came, wind blew. My house was filled on.
Just them. I'm safe.
I'm safe. Well,
one voice we sing, yeah.
Rain came through my house was filled on. Say with you, I'm gonna make it.
Build it up, say
rain came.
Rain came. Through, say,
I'm gonna make it through.
Cause I'm standing strong.
I'm standing strong.
Yeah. He's the chief cornerstone.
Everything around me.
I've never been more glad.
And
I put my faith on.
I put my faith in Jesus.
He's never let me down.
He's
Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I
He's faithful. Remind yourself that he won't. Despite of what they say, yeah, he won't. Despite of what it looks like, yeah, yeah, he won't fail. He won't fail. He won't say, yeah, he won't. He won't fail. My grandma would say that he's an on-time God. He's an on-time God. No matter what situation you're facing in your life, doesn't matter what the doctor told you, doesn't matter what you see on the news, doesn't matter what you read about on social media, we serve a God that hasn't failed, that won't fail. If you're grateful that we serve a God that won't fail, make some noise in this room. Come on. If you're already victorious because you serve a God who has made a way out of no way, come on. If you've seen him work in your life time after time, come on. Come on. Where's my true worshipers? My true praisers? Come on. Who's seen God work time after time again? Come on. Yeah, he won't fail, no. Come on, that's good news, come on. He won't fail, no. He won't fail, no. One more time. He won't fail. He won't. He won't fail. Last time, he won't fail. He won't, yes. Come on, clap your hands, make some noise. Hallelujah. Do me a favor, hug the person next to you. Tell them you're glad to see them in the room. Encourage them. Come on, love on them. And as you take your seats, pay attention to the monitors for the announcements. Love you guys.
WCC family and friends, my name is Parrish Watson, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to service today. We pray that you are blessed in today's service and that you come back and join us again. In times like these, it's really important that we stay connected and informed. So here's a rundown of everything you need to know about what's happening here at WCC. Hi, are you new to our WCC family? Welcome to you. Please join us for anything you hear in today's announcements. We also invite you to stop in our guest lounge or at our welcome desk in the lobby directly after service. We would love to say hello. Looking to go deeper in the Word? Join us at 7 p.m. on Wednesday evenings for a special series of midweek classes taught by Pastor Paul Authors. The topic for March will be deliverance. All are welcome to meet at our Carroll Stream campus and participate in this opportunity to hear and discuss truths found in God's Word. Have you joined a Connect group yet? Our spring sessions of groups has begun, and there is still time to sign up. Visit our website to get connected with a small group that is just right for you. Our next service of baby dedication will be held on March 24th. If you have a baby or a child that you would like to be dedicated, please sign up on the Church Center app for more details. Are you interested in taking the next steps in your faith journey? Our next service of baptism will be held on March 24th. at our Killstream location. Be sure to go to the Church Center app to register for baptism class to learn all about this important commitment in your walk with Christ. We are looking forward to celebrating Holy Week with our WCC family. Make plans to bring the entire family out for a special Good Friday service on March 29th at our Killstream campus. We will have a powerful, dramatic presentation, a great time of worship and fellowship. Also, join us for our Resurrection Day service in Aurora and Killstream on March 31st. This will be a special opportunity to invite someone to be your special guest as we celebrate our risen Savior. Thanks so much for joining us today. For more details of any of our announcements, be sure to visit our Church Center app, our website, and our social media sites to stay up to date. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Praise the Lord. Good morning, Wheaton Christian Center. Are you happy and blessed today? You have a good week? Okay. I'd like to hear that. Well, I'm glad for the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord with believers, and we are excited about what God is doing in the lives of his people. Right now, I just ask you to prepare your hearts and giving and receiving. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the privilege of giving. We don't have to give. We get to give. In response, Lord, to your love, because you love and you gave your very best. Lord, we sang about your name being Jehovah Jireh. You are more than enough in your provision. You give us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Thank you, Lord, for the wisdom and the grace to steward everything that you've entrusted us with, our Lord God, so that we can, our Lord, see the covenant of God established here on the earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead and obey God. I want to encourage you about some wonderful things that are happening. We're having a service of baptism on Palm Sunday, the Sunday before Easter, Resurrection Sunday. People are going to go through the waters of baptism. And that's something I am very passionate about. I am finding myself taking a fresh look at discipleship and what it means to be a follower of Christ. And I've become more and more aware that we need to step it up in some areas as believers when it comes to real commitment. And I encourage you, if you have repented and you have not gone through the waters of baptism, since you have repented, you need to go through the waters of baptism and sign up to be a part of that wonderful experience. So make sure you do that. On Wednesday night, we have started our teaching on deliverance. It's something the Lord impressed in my heart. As you know, in light of the Lord's soon return, we have work to do, and we are transforming generations into followers of Christ. And God does not want his people in bondage. God wants you to stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has made you free. And too many Christians who've been made free are living in bondage, and that is not God's will. In every area of your life, you need to be free. And so we invite you at 7 o'clock. We will have, you know, quiet time of prayer at 6:30. You can come in and just take time to pray and meditate. But we'll start promptly at 7, and we will see the power of God manifest as the word of God is declared in the lives of his people. So I encourage you to come out. There is also a petition that we've made available, and you'll find it. It should be out in the lobby, or you can ask one of the leaders about that petition. But what it simply says, and you can take a look at it, it's something that we need so many signatures. who are aligned, that would sign and it would go on the ballot when it comes to people making decisions about who they would like to have in positions of power. It will be right there for the people to decide, so that things just don't happen to us and our family. And we know in this church we believe that God created them male and female. And this legislation simply states, and you go read it yourself and see if it's something that you agree with that should be put on the ballot, but it simply states that the parents and the communities say, we do not want any gender-altering surgery performed without parental consent on the children. That's what it says. That's available, and they need so many signatures, and so as a community of faith, we are coming in agreement with those things that are aligned with the Word of God as we teach. Thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we bless you and thank you for today, an opportunity to gather around your Word. And Lord, we expect to be transformed, to be changed as we receive the Word that brings life. We receive it with joy and we are changed in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want you to turn your Bibles with me to Romans chapter 1. We're going to look at that passage of Scripture again as we've been discussing recalibrate. If I'm going to give today's message a subtitle, I would call it Righteous Judgment. Righteous Judgment. The Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, for the Jew first, and also for the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just or the righteous shall live by faith. Verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. In this passage, we see that the gospel reveals the righteousness of God, but on the flip side, the wrath of God is also revealed. So we have the righteousness of God revealed, but the Bible says the wrath of God is also revealed against unrighteousness. So we see and we've learned that God's justice is part and parcel of his righteousness. So when the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, you cannot separate God's justice. Now, when we stand in this office, we understand that it's a very sacred thing that we do when we communicate the Word of God. And I like to encourage, feed, build up God's people, according to Ephesians chapter 4, to do the work of the ministry. But the Bible says we have this treasure in earthen vessels. And last week I was sharing some things that I felt it was brought to my attention. Maybe I need to clean up just a touch before we go on. We are aware of some things that have happened in the community. Early last month, there was a shooting that involved an unarmed man. And we have been involved working with city leaders and wanting to be a source of blessing and, peace, which includes righteous judgment. But in communicating some things, I mentioned that the person was a suspect of domestic violence, and that's what triggered the activity of the police. And I said last week, in communicating that I didn't see how a domestic violence issue warranted such force, it being treated like it was a capital offense. It was not in any way minimizing the real threat and the trauma of domestic violence. That was not my intent in communicating that. So I wanted to clarify that because the last thing we want to do in ministering the Word of God is be an offense. Now, if the scripture is an offense, then I can't do anything about it. But if the vessel is an offense in the way that the vessel communicates, then I have to humble myself and correct that. So that was not my intent in communicating that. As we go forth and we're talking about righteous judgment, one of the things that are critical in the life of the believer is righteous judgment. Righteous judgment. We understand that God is the righteous judge. When God was getting ready to bring judgment, because we read that the wrath of God is revealed against all unrighteousness. Unrighteousness invites and causes the wrath of God to be manifest. Not necessarily a feel-good gospel that I'm preaching right now, but it is good news that God judges unrighteousness. He's the judge of all the earth. So when God was getting ready to bring his wrath upon Sodom and Gomorrah, who was practicing immoral living, they were inviting God's judgment. And when Abraham began to intervene because his nephew Lot was living in Sodom, he began to intervene. One of the things he said in his prayer, recognizing that God was the judge, and he understood that God, as the judge of all the earth, shall do right. So even when God invokes his wrath, the wrath of God is perfectly just. God never goes overboard with his wrath. His wrath is his justice upon evil, upon sin. The wages of sin is death. So whenever a person is in sin, or whenever an individual sins, there's a check in the mail that is coming. The wages of sin brings the wrath of God. But the Bible says that for the believer, God has not appointed the believer unto wrath. But the wrath of God is revealed against all unrighteousness. God's judgment is just. Psalm 19, it says, probably around verse 8 or 9, that the judgment of the Lord is right. So God, his judgments are right on target. One of the things that I pray for personally in my life is righteous judgment. You ever run into a person that just has sound judgment? A person who has sound judgment doesn't fall into the same pitfalls as people who have no judgment. Your righteous judgment that influences the decisions that you make. Your righteous judgment says that you deem some things as appropriate and you deem others as inappropriate. As we are recalibrating, we are coming into proper alignment with God's standard. And so that's why there is an emphasis on the righteousness of God, because righteousness, right standing with God, implies that there are things that are moving and shifting to come into that place of right standing. When we speak of justice, and you can follow me in the notes, justice speaks of the proper execution of righteousness. It's not really the revelation of righteousness when justice is separated from that. Justice is righteousness being executed. The proper execution of righteousness. And when we speak of judgment, we're talking about the exercising of the process of government. To exercise the process of government to distinguish between good and evil. I want to share with you three things concerning the righteousness, because we see in Romans that in the gospel that the righteousness of God is revealed. And really, that is my prayer. My prayer in the lives of God's people, that through it all, the righteousness of God will be revealed. There are all kinds of things that we deal with. There are things that manifest in the lives of people. But as far as you are concerned, my prayer is that God's righteousness will be revealed. As you hunger and thirst for righteousness, as you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, may it be revealed in your life. For in the kingdom, according to Romans 14, verse 17, is righteousness, peace, and joy. When God's rule, God's reign, God's authority is extended, and you are an extension wherever you go of God's kingdom, wherever you go, whether to school, work, home, you are extending God's rule. You are bringing God's kingdom, God's management upon anything that you have influence over. You're bringing in God's culture, God's way of doing things. My prayer is that there's going to be a manifestation. Righteousness is revealed by faith. The righteousness of God, we're talking about the righteousness of God being manifest. The only way it's going to be manifest is if you and I start to believe God. And when we believe God, the righteousness of God is manifest. Faith, we know, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Pastor Carlton gave us a practical definition. Faith being a word in your mouth that you believe in your heart based on God's word and endorsed to you by the Holy Spirit and acted upon. Says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God. I like to always pause right there, because you can't have the gospel without the power. You can't have the truth without the power. If your life has no power, then it's a sign that the gospel has not reached or influenced you, because you cannot separate the power of God from the gospel. It's the power of God to transform you, to make you a new creature. The gospel is revealed by faith. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God unto salvation, for in it the righteousness of God is revealed by faith. Why? For the righteous shall live by faith. So it goes beyond just a religious exercise into the life. My burden is not for people just to come and gather for worship, but as a man or woman of faith, it has to get into your life. There's no split personality or split life for the believer. The same person you are as you're gathered around believers is the same person you are wherever you go. This is your life. And that's the difference between those who just maybe are religious, show up here and there for a religious event and try to be a good person, versus the person who walks by faith. Religion is a lot of work, because I got to do this to be a good person. I got to do this. And there's a righteousness that is not of faith. The righteousness that has nothing to do with faith, that's your righteousness. That's your own effort. That's you trying. That's you exercising your willpower to try to be a good person. And whenever you try to be a good person, you always realize that you're not. Whenever you say, I'm gonna be saved, I'm gonna be a Christian, we always fall on our face. Because we can't. Our righteousness, our goodness, is never good enough. Paul says, I count everything that I've accomplished as garbage in Philippians chapter 3, around verse 8. He says, I count it all as garbage. I've let it go that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness, I'm in verse 9 now, which is of my own. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness versus our righteousness. There are two types of righteousness. There's your righteousness and there's his righteousness. What you have been made, you believe God. Abraham believed God. You believe what God says in spite of what you see in the natural. You believe that God says that you are a woman of God. You are a virtuous woman. God says you are a man of excellence. You are a righteous man. And there's nothing that you have in your life to prove that. Your friends, your family, they don't see you that way. But God says, if you believe me, and if you believe who I say you are, that's who you are, in spite of the history. And in spite of your track record, that's who you are. The righteousness that is by faith. Abraham believed God. And although, as we said last week, Abraham was a liar. Lied. Said, nah, she's not my wife, she's my sister. Isaac said, she's not my wife, she's my sister. Esau, the one that was lied to. Jacob. Said, I'm not Jacob, I'm Esau. All of Jacob's sons, except Joseph and Benjamin, 10 of his sons, 10 of Jacob's sons, said, your son, the one that you love, the one that you're showing favoritism, eaten by animals. But God said, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to his account for righteousness. So Romans chapter 4, verse 5 tells us, it's to him that worketh not, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited for righteousness. So I want to encourage you today to believe God. Believe God in spite of what you see in the natural, of how you feel, or the report of man. Righteousness is revealed by faith. Righteousness is revealed by faith, and righteousness is a practice of faith. Righteousness is the practice of faith. 1 John chapter 3, verse 7 says that God doesn't want you to be deceived about who's righteousness, who's righteous, and who's unrighteous. 1 John 3, verse 7 says, whoever practices righteousness is righteous. It's in the practice. That's where it is. And people miss it because they just want an experience. You know, I'm caring less and less about your worship experience. Because we've made everything about experience. You have the smoke and the lights and everything. And we end up with a wonderful, incredible experience, and people can move from experience to experience, but there's no life of faith, there's no walk. Whoever practices righteousness, it's not someone who experience has an experience. We come and we say, if you, I'm not trying to completely bash it. I'm just challenging it. I'm a part of it. But we say, come to the altar and give your life to Jesus because you know you're a sinner. The Holy Spirit convicts you and, yep, I'm a sinner. I know I need to, I don't want to die like this. I don't want to face the judgment of God. And so I better come to the altar. And we come, have the ministers here, and we pray. Romans 10, 9 and 10, if you confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that God has raised Jesus from the dead, you shall be saved. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer, sinner's prayer. God always hears a sinner's prayer. And you pray the prayer, Jesus, I believe that you died for me, that you love me, that you rose again. I open my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. Make me new. Forgive me, I am now your child, I renounce the devil, all his works, I give my life to you totally and completely, you're my Lord. If that's it, scripture is kind of scary. There is a scripture in Matthew chapter 7, Sermon on the Mount, and around verse in the 20s, maybe it's verse 21, Jesus says, not everybody who says Lord. I don't know, but that one's scary. Because whenever someone dies who we really can't preach about how they're living in terms of salvation. We can't really have much to eulogize about their walk with God. The best thing we got is we put it in the obituary that they accepted Jesus at an early age. But not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, that scripture is so scary, we need to probably look at it. I say it's scary because it should put the fear of God in you. Verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter. I'm going to let that silence just sit and be uncomfortable. Not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom. Not everybody who comes to the altar, lifts their hands and say, Jesus, come into my heart, shall enter. We've made it an experience. And if you've had the experience, you're good. But in the early church, before they were called Christians in Antioch, they were called people of the way. They were called the way. The way, saying that they are pilgrims and they're on a journey. They're following Jesus in life. They believe in the resurrection and their life is on a path. The person who practices, I'm talking about practice. The person who continues. See, a lot of people start. A lot of people start and fall off. We start, fall off, start again, start, just like my exercise program. Just like my eating healthy. I do eat healthy in spurts. The difference is in the practice. Your neighbor doesn't believe you. Tell him I'm talking about practice. That's what we're talking about right now. That's exactly what we're talking about. We're talking about practice. Because the person who practices righteousness is righteous. The person who has righteousness as an event, that's why we got so much shallowness. That's why our children, if it's just an experience, and they just have an experience, and then they go about their business, and they have other experiences that we don't like, moving from experience to experience. Faith is not an experience. Faith is not an event. Faith is the way we live. It's the way we walk. It's the way we go to work. It's the way we go to school. It's the way we talk. It's the way we think. Early church, Pentecost, Holy Ghost fire, people filled with the Holy Spirit, 120 in the upper room, 3,000 souls saved. What must we do to be saved? Verse 37. Believe, repent, and let every one of you be baptized. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's around verse 38. When you get to verse 42, 3,000 souls are saved. What do? And they continued. That's the difference. And they continued in the apostles' teaching, and in breaking of bread, and in fellowship. The difference between the one who says, Lord, Lord, and the one who does, is the one that does is the one that continues doing. That's the difference. The difference is, for some, they're just going through a difficult season right now, and so they want to get help, and so they come to try to get help. But the person who's entering the kingdom is the person who is on the way, the person who's living on the path of righteousness. That's the difference. To continue to practice means this is where you live. You live here. You don't stop. I always talk about my time when I was living in Zimbabwe. This was as I was finding my wife, all that kind of stuff was happening. I learned about prayer. I thought I knew about prayer, but I didn't really know about prayer. I said, these people pray. These people can pray. As I'm training in the ministry, Friday, there's pastor's prayer. Now, you, as a pastor, you're supposed to pray and fast on Fridays. That was the thing. So Fridays, we fasted, and we go. First, me and Apostle Steve, we were living together, and so we had a rhythm. At 5 o'clock in the morning, we come out, he and I, and we're praying. We live the same place. We come and we pray, 5 in the morning. And then by 9 o'clock, we need to get to headquarters and get to the office, where there is now pastor's prayer. A pastor's prayer on Friday is going from 9 o'clock. Now, we're supposed to end at 12. But now, Mama Goody's there, and she's going to extend it, and so we don't get out until 4. Now, where I was, there are some churches that had all-night prayer, but the church I was pastoring, I said, you know what? Look, let's do prayer from 6 to 10. And let some other campus, they'll do all night. We'll go from 6 to 10. That's good. Because I got to get to sleep. This particular day, go from prayer 6 to 10. Holy Ghost fire prayer. I mean, in those prayer meetings, they're very loud. Very loud. A lot of work. Not so much of the contemplation, quiet meditation. You do have those moments, but most time, I mean, I'm still thrown off because you talk about the wailing women praying, the women of Zion. I still got some questions because I've seen some of these women. We talking before the prayer starts, and when the prayer starts, 30 seconds in, they're wailing. They're crying. Now, come on, it takes a longer time to work up, you know, to get to the point where you're crying and weeping. I got questions, but that's how they were. I remember pastoring in Atlanta, someone's mother died in Orlando, so we drove. And I drove the church bus. We had some of the sisters in there, and we're making our way. We're talking, chilling the whole time, going to this person's, who's in the church. Their mother died in Zimbabwe. We're all in America. They didn't know the mother of this person in Zimbabwe because they're in America, but I had some of the older mothers in the church there in the car with me. We're driving together, having a good time, and finally get to the house. This person lives in like a 3-bedroom apartment with their family, and we get to the house, you know, the person's taken off work now because they're just mourning the loss of the mother. We drove for about 2.5, to Orlando, it was about 6 hours, I think. We drove to get there, and we arrive, and I'm ready to walk in there, you know, so sorry, and have something to drink, maybe a little refreshment now because we drove 6 hours. I walk in there with my team. Now, I didn't know who they were. They didn't identify themselves before. I was kind of new to pastoring in that setting. I didn't really know, but they should have identified themselves as the wailing women. Because as soon as I walked in the house, they started crying. Scared the mess out of me. Uh,
they know how to cry in prayer. So back to my time, we're continuing. We're practicing. I said 6 to 10 prayer, right? Start at 5 o'clock, 6 to 10, we're good. Unfortunately, when I came out of prayer, they said, oh, there was a call. Mama Goody is calling you. They have an all-night prayer. Somewhere I had to hitchhike, get a bus, and go to this place. The church didn't even have a roof at the time, and it was winter. I was being disrespectful to the Zimbabwe winter because I'm from Chicago, so I'm showing up there in a t-shirt. I didn't realize it can get cold at night during the winter. So anyway, I'm there, and we're praying, and they're going on and on. We're talking about practice, and we're talking about continuing. They're going on and on in this prayer, and every time someone stands up, I think that each time we're going to close this prayer out because it's too cold. Each time someone stands up, they say, they start off leading this next item, saying, as we continue. Next person, and they say, whenever they say, as we continue, that's an hour. That's an hour. I mean, by this time, I've binded, I've loosed, I've been running, I've been exercising. There are no more devils. We've chased them all out. Anyone who's sick, I mean, there's a person who had a pain in their leg while we're praying and walk around. Oh, you got to pay. You be healed. Check your leg. Yeah. That's 3 o'clock in the morning. Next person comes up. All right, this is the final one. Final prayer request, and they call it out, and then we pray for another hour. I'm ready to go, but I got my strength because the person said, "This is our last one." And then what happens? Mama Goody again. She gets up there and says, as we continue. At that time, that was a time I revolted, I rebelled. I said, no, you guys are liars. You guys are liars. I'm out of here. And I left, and I found the car, and I went to sleep. Because I said, these people lie. As we continue. As they continued in the apostles' teaching. This is what it means to walk by faith. And to manifest the righteousness of God, you have to continue through everything. And that's the difference. Righteousness is a fact. If you abide in me, this is where you live. If you abide. Righteousness is a practice of faith. It continues. It corrects. Psalm 23 says, as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Remember, the previous verse says he leads us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear. Walking, being led through the paths of righteousness so that I can manifest righteousness sometimes will lead me through the valley of the shadow of death. But while I'm walking through the valley of the shadow of death, I don't fear on the path of righteousness. Why? Because thy rod and thy staff provide comfort. The rod is not necessarily a comfortable tool as far as the sheep is concerned, because the rod will bring you back in line. The staff can be used to pull you out, but the rod will correct you. As you are practicing, some of us
When we're practicing, we realize and we're aware of some things that we're practicing that is wrong, and the rod corrects us. The rod of the Word of God brings us back into alignment. It recalibrates. It corrects. Whom the Lord loves, He corrects. The work of the Holy Spirit is to correct. He will convict the world, John 16, he will convict the world of righteousness and of judgment. As I practice righteousness, it's going to correct. So the practice continues, the practice is going to correct, and the practice creates. Because remember, as you abide, you bear much fruit. Fruit, the manifestation, is in the practice. When you abide, you begin to abound. The more you abide, the more you abound. It corrects. Righteousness is the practice of faith, but righteousness is also the execution of justice. Righteousness is the execution of justice. And when we're talking about justice in our lives, when we're talking about judgment in our lives, judgment is always confrontational. Judgment is unpopular today because our knee-jerk response is not to judge. But in the church, Paul says we ought to judge. We don't judge who's saved and who's not saved. But John the Baptist does say, bring forth fruit. We are able to inspect fruit, bring forth fruit of your repentance. But Jesus says, judge not that you be not judged. But righteous judgment executes justice. And justice is confrontational. There are some things that we have to deal with. Justice is going to address sin in our lives. Justice is going to address that thing that we don't want to deal with, that is necessary for our transformation. It's the justice of God that punishes the evil. Ought not this woman, who is a daughter of Abraham, Luke chapter 13, around verse 13, the woman comes, spirit of infirmity, bowed over, couldn't lift herself up. And it's on a day where the religious establishment says he's not supposed to heal. And Jesus says, ought not this woman, be the daughter of Abraham, be loosed? The activity of the enemy is in her life, and she should be free from the bondage of the enemy. And so Jesus says she ought to be loosed. Ought not this couple who is married in the Lord be loosed from the bondage of strife and unforgiveness? Ought not this individual be loosed from the unforgiveness? Ought not this individual be loosed from the sickness? Whenever Jesus points a finger of authority and ministers healing, breaking the power of the kingdom of darkness that's been in operation and separating the darkness from the individual so that the person can be free, that is God's judgment upon that evil, upon that foul spirit that has been tormenting, that thing that has been plaguing you. That's the judgment of God. There are some things in your life that need to be judged, and until they're judged, they're going to stay right there. And it'll be illegal activity in your life until that thing is judged. Righteous judgments brings judgment to that thing which is causing the devastation or the problem. Justice is confrontational. And so, we're going to confront some things in Jesus' name. There are some things that you've been allowing to let slide. But in the justice of God, he doesn't let it slide. There are some things that we've been tolerating. But in God's justice, you can no longer tolerate this. You're going to have to say, you know what? I can't live like this. I have to bring God's justice to this area. So, a lot of times, the righteousness of God is not manifest because we have not dealt with some deep issues. We have not dealt with some deep areas of sin, iniquity, that is causing the problem. It's causing the lack of fruit in our lives. There are some things that we haven't dealt with. And so in Joshua chapter 7, the children of Israel, they've been delivered from Egypt, and they've been called as a chosen people of God to go and possess the land. In chapter 6, they march around the walls of Jericho. It all comes down. God gives instructions. Jericho, everything in it, the gold, the silver, the things that are precious, those things are mine. I want everything burned up. I want everything destroyed. This is the first city that they went to, and Jericho was a type of the tithe. The tithe is the first fruit that belongs to God. So before they conquered any other cities, before they knew that they were going to conquer any other cities, God said, the very first one, I want you to give it to me. It's mine. It's sacred. There was a man by the name of Achan in Joshua chapter 7 who saw a beautiful outfit. He saw a beautiful Babylonian garment. And he saw, some treasure, some gold, and he buried it in his tent. Now they're moving on from Jericho, and there's a small town, Ai, and they're the anointed people of God. They're chosen. God has given them the land, and they're going now to possess the land that God has given them. And as they go to do battle with this much smaller town, Ai defeats the armies of Israel. I mean, they overthrew the world superpower of the day, Egypt. These impenetrable walls of Jericho came down supernaturally. And now, this army that's on the move, you're losing to Ai? What in the world is this? This is what many of our lives look like. You're a child of the King. Jesus is Savior and Lord of your life. But yet in life, the righteousness of God is not manifest in your life. And you're losing to Ai, even though you're a covenant child of God. Evil is allowed to prevail in your life. It's not God's will. It's not God's will for evil to prevail in your life. The children of God are losing to Ai, and they have to deal with something that's hidden. It's something that is buried in the ground. Something that they don't see, but they're going to have to search for. Sometimes we have to take time to discover, what is it? Why am I losing when I'm born of God? Why am I being defeated when I'm born of God? It ought to make you question some things. You should not be losing and living in defeat and living can't sleep, being visited at night by spirits, being tormented, being depressed, suicidal thoughts, living with incurable diseases because this is what the doctor says is your lot in life because it's your bloodline. No, why am I losing as a child of God? Why am I walking in defeat? Why am I not seeing the victory? It doesn't mean that you don't have challenges, but you should not have the same challenges over and over and over and over. You should move on to some new challenges because you're taking territory. Why are you losing to Ai? I like the fact that Joshua, the successor of Moses, we see that he begins to tear his clothes in verse 13. God now speaks because Joshua says, Lord, this is an embarrassment. What are we going to say? All the nations now are just going to come and wipe us out because there'll be no fear of our God. There's no respect for our God. They're just going to wipe us out. And Joshua has declared a fast. He's praying. He's seeking God. And God says, what are you doing? Prayer without dealing with the issue is fruitless. Some of us are really good at praying, consistent in praying, and we can pray the paint off the wall. What we can't do is deal with some things that are buried. And it doesn't matter how long Joshua prays. It doesn't matter how long he fasts. He can fast until he falls over. And they will continue to lose. Some things are not answered by prayer, but they're answered by obedience. If prayer does not lead you to obedience, you have husbands that ignore their wives, ignore their children, but they can pray up a storm. I'm amazed at the ability and the grace that some people have in prayer. And you wonder, you can pray like this, but in the private messages, is this? How can you have this prayer and this private message? You got to dig, and there's something buried that needs to be judged. I'm talking about righteous judgment. There are some things that are there that are hidden that need to be judged. And until they are judged, there's no fruit and there's no victory. Until some things are judged. The sword is for judgment. And the sword of the Spirit is for judgment. What is in your life that's been allowed to be buried that has not been judged? So God says to Joshua, there's sin in the camp, and until you judge the sin, until you call it out and bring it to judgment, there's going to be no change in your outcome. Doesn't matter how much you pray, doesn't matter how much you give, doesn't matter how much you come to church, until you deal with the issue, there's no victory. The word of God, sword of the Spirit, is quick, it's alive, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. But this sword is not for decoration. The sword is an instrument of death. And there are some things that have to die. There are some things that have to be judged. There are some things that have to be called out. There are some things that we're going to have to go to war. And we're going to have to fight it until it's dead. Because as long as it's living until it's judged, there's no victory. Stand to your feet. Praise his name. He's a righteous judge. And in the kingdom of God, he's given you and he's given me authority. He's given us authority to exercise righteous judgment. It's not with other people. It's not judging other people. But God wants you to exercise righteous judgment in your life. He wants you to exercise the sword of the Spirit and allow the Word of God to address some things that maybe you've let pass. And for your victory and for your future, it's critical that you deal with those things. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. God, you are good. You're faithful. You're worthy. We invite you, Lord. Search us. Search our heart. Try us. See if there be any wicked way. May the words of our mouth, the meditations of our heart be acceptable in your sight. Lord, we don't want to just go through the motions. We don't want to just go from experience to experience without being changed because we never allowed you to touch us. Because we never allowed you to address the dysfunctional behavior, the patterns that need to come to a screeching halt in our lives. We've never dealt with the anger. We've never dealt with the source of pain. We haven't dealt with the issues that have been shaping our choices and decisions. But we've just been going. But we open ourselves right now. Holy Spirit, you are the one that convicts. Thank you, Lord, that even now you're bringing those areas to our attention, those deep places. Those deep places you're bringing to our attention, those deep places that need to be dealt with, that need to be judged, where we need to speak the word of God, where Satan needs to be cast out, where the powers and the strongholds need to be broken, Lord. I pray right now that God illuminate your mind for you to see those things that you buried, those things that you thought you got away with. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, by the word of God, by the Spirit of God, we give you permission. We submit ourselves. We yield ourselves. We yield the members of our body to be instruments of righteousness, Lord, to go deep. Lord, to do a deep work in our heart so that we can manifest and show forth the praises of him who's called us out of darkness. That's our prayer today, Lord. That's our cry. Lord, we don't want to just go through the motions. We don't want to just go through church, Lord. We want to give you permission. Holy Spirit, we open our heart, Lord, for your righteousness to be revealed. Some of you, the enemy is trying to make a mockery of you. He's trying to make you an embarrassment to the world and so that your witness is affected so nobody can follow Christ because they see your life. The enemy tried to make a mockery of the people of God by compromise, by saying that you can play both sides. It's the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. Some things are buried. They're buried deep. But Hosea says, break up the fallow ground. Break up the fallow ground. There are some things, in order to get to it, it's so secure. It's so entrenched. It's so much a part of you. It's buried deep. Even strongholds require foundations. There's some things that are buried deep. But the Holy Spirit searches the deep things. The word of God discerns to the deep places. Allow God to go there. Allow God to go there. Allow the areas that are hardened the areas that are stubborn, the areas that don't want to change, allow God to go there. In Jesus' name, to the deep places, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. We submit to you, Lord. If in any way we're otherwise minded, if we have another idea, if we're stuck, Lord God, if we have hidden iniquity, your eyes are holier eyes than to look upon iniquity. It's been creating separation. And we ask you to forgive us. We ask you to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that we can show forth and manifest your glory in the earth. In Jesus' name. If you need to do business with God, if you need to be baptized, if you need to get right, before you get right, you got to get uncomfortable with being wrong and being off and being lukewarm and being shallow. You have to get uncomfortable with some things if you're going to get right. This is the most uncomfortable space in the sanctuary. Very uncomfortable. Growth is uncomfortable. Change is uncomfortable. Transformation is uncomfortable. We get uncomfortable before we can receive some things from God. So I encourage you to get uncomfortable with your routine if the Holy Spirit is dealing with your heart. The altar is open. The altar is open. I'm not looking for a one-time experience. You're not a one-hit wonder. But there's the beginning. There's the initial impact. So we want to open the altar to you. Those of you who are watching online, you can get stuck in the routine of defeat because there's unconfessed sin in your life. The Holy Spirit is bringing these areas to your attention. God loves you. That's the only reason why he's showing you these things about you that have to change, that have to be submitted. You need to bring judgment by speaking and declaring the word of God over those areas that are out of line. You have to call them out. As long as you ignore them, they'll stay there. But you'll be ineffective and you won't manifest the righteousness of God. So if you're sincere, talk to God. It's a start, it's not a finish, but pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your son. I receive your son as my Lord and Savior. I believe that you died for me, that you were buried, and that you rose again. And I surrender my life to you. I give you my life totally and completely. I renounce the devil and all of his works, and I choose to walk by faith in a new life. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness and your grace and goodness. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in our midst. We bless you, Lord, that we will continue in the teaching of your word and in fellowship with the believers from house to house, wherever we go. As we leave this place, we leave under your protection. May no evil befall us, no plague, accident, mishap of any kind come near us. May all of us reach our destination, come back in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of Christ, with the testimony of leading someone to Jesus and bringing them to church with us, to the glory of God. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We're going to be ministering here at the altar. And we're going to be touching an agreement to exercise judgment on these areas of bondage. I don't care if it's sickness, disease. I don't care if it's depression. I don't care if it's anxiety. I don't care if it's addiction. I don't care if it's a cyst, something that is stubborn that doesn't want to leave. Whatever it is, we're exercising the judgment of God, and there's healing and deliverance in God's judgment. There is freedom in God's judgment. So don't leave oppressed, depressed, confused. Receive everything God has for you. Wheaton Christian Center. God bless you. You are dismissed. If you need prayer, come forward. You need to get saved. You need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You need